start with you, Susan, and talk a little bit about what the drug war has cost you personally.
So, Asha, I'd like to start with you. I'd like to start with you because I know you, you know, as a woman, a black woman, who has stood in the places that we don't always get to come into, the rooms and the conversations that we don't always get to have. But you stood in front of us ensuring that we are represented and usher the resources to us for us to continue to be able to be resourced to actually be in this fight. You are the longest standing black female program officer that I know. And you can, and when you stand, come into the room, we need to look at you and understand and acknowledge who you are and what you do. So I'm going to ask everybody to stand and applaud Asha and recognize who she is and what she does. Because I know it's all types of fights that go on, and you know, and I just had to say that because there's some mornings, early mornings, and conference calls that you're always on in, and you're always on point, and you know, I know that there's conversations that I'm not privy to that happen. It's just part of the game. It's just part of the flow. So thank you for being that warrior.
Love you, Asha.
We love you, Asha. Yeah. So the cost of the drug war for me, and I'll say for us, I mean, it's tremendous and it continues. So just to let people who don't know me know a little bit about me, 1982, I had a son who was 5 years old. He was killed by a police officer. And, you know, it was an accident. The police officer ran him over. But the police officer never, ever stopped his car and got out. The police department never said, I'm sorry. All I know today is his name. And that's because I read it in the LA Times. After his death, I began to drink heavily. And, you know, crack came to every corner, and I took crack, and I got sent to prison. I got sent to prison not one time, but six times. I was convicted of possession of a controlled substance and sent to prison. I think it was the third time I threw myself on the mercy of the court, and I said, Your Honor, and I went through a whole litany of my life, of what my life had been like up until my son's death, and that just, you know, threw me all overboard. Excuse me, but that MF still said state prison 3 years.
That MF.
After my sixth incarceration, I found a place that I could go in Santa Monica, upscale community. And I went in there and I got treatment. They called it treatment for drug addiction, but what I found was compassion for my addiction and services to help me to rise above it. You know, like therapy weekly, medical services, dental services, and most of all, compassion. And I got better. But in that time, you know, what I found is that, what I saw is that the community in which I was in, they got handed a court card instead of some chains. They were diverted to different types of treatment and different types of groups and different types of meetings that I never got a crack at. And so I left that treatment facility after 100 days and said, this shit is crazy. You know, why was I chained up and put in a cage like an animal? You know, why didn't someone tell me there was a way to deal with my grief and a way to deal with my anger, a way to deal with my rage? And quite frankly, had I not had something to medicate my pain, my anger, my grief, I might have went down to the Wilshire police station and shot that thing up. You know, they took my son and never even said, Miss Burton, I'm sorry. Never acknowledged it. So, you know, I lost 20 years, or I gave 20 years. I don't want to say I lost it because I learned so much in that 20 years that informs my work today. So I left that treatment facility and got a minimum wage job, and I saved my money and I bought a little house, and I went down to the bus station where women were getting off the bus. All the women I know, all the women that was trapped up just like me with some types of substance abuse or incarceration problem, and said, hey girl, I got a home, come on over here, and there's a new way of life is born. So in providing and creating this community, I saw the rapid discrimination that people face. You know, I don't want to say as a result of incarceration. I want to say as a result of being black in America. You know, I saw babies snatched. I saw, you know, denial all across the board. You know, I saw what I really am clear on today is the treatment industrial complex that reproduces racism while they say I'm helping you, but I think you're really reinstituting and hurting us. And if anybody's in here and you're working with folks and you say you're fixing them, are giving them an opportunity, and it's based under federal government money, you're lying. Because what I found is through those contracts and those resources that you have to continue to push that racism and treatment of people that just, it isn't right, it isn't healthy. You know, it isn't good for them. As a result of that, I terminated. I terminated last year every government, every county contract that I had and said, we will survive. We'll make it through, but I'm not going to do what you're asking me to do to report on my people the way you're asking me to report on my people. I'm not going to tell you when they're brushing their teeth and when they're laying down in the bed. You know, I'm not going to give you their birth date, their social security number, and all of the things that you're asking me to do. I'm just not going to do it.
Pause there for one second, because I want people to really hear what you said. We had a question before about how you run a workplace, right, and do it ethically.
Yeah.
Not harm people who use drugs and not harm people, period.
Right.
The vulnerable position that most of our not-for-profit organizations are in, especially ones that are run by black women and black men, is incredible. When we started this grants program, Ethan and I, you know, when I sat down with him and said, you know, we're basically going to guarantee people as long as they do the work, they're giving the grant.
Yeah.
That's it. There's not a million things that you have to report. It's not, because it's too hard. And the more that we push people into doing grants as though they're making widgets and not saving lives is just incredibly ridiculous. And so I just really want to acknowledge the courage that you did and just say, you know, when she puts a Kickstarter out there, when she sends something around that says, I need $5, take $5 out and put it in a new way of life's work.
So I guess, you know, what you can say is, you know, we're building a way out up under what the traditional, like, America thinks is a way out. And I see so many providers that keep people pinned up in cages. I mean, I had $15-hour jobs last week, and I went to the treatment facility, and they said, they're not ready to work. Well, what the hell you mean they're not ready to work? You know, I mean, a part of living today is being employed, gainful employment. And $15 an hour ain't bad. It ain't 50 or 100, but it's a start at building an income. But that's the way in which I see people really held hostage, sitting in groups, talking about what I did wrong. Not why and what the culture and what the environment's about. You know, what pushed me there. You know, what caused, you know, what, why, you know, so anyway, that's my story, that's my frame, you know, that's what, you know, I feel like we, especially the 70 million formerly incarcerated people in this nation, yeah, just like Dorothy said, they need to come out. We need to stand up. We need to organize. We need to take a day and flood this country with our faces and demand our right to be, you know, just here.
Thank you so much, Cindy.
Oh, one thing. And Dr. Hart, I wonder, many times I wonder, you know, if my son would be at Columbia or in one of those prisons. I wonder that, you know, a lot of times. Yeah, so.
Thank you so much, Susan.
Yeah.
Hold the space on this a minute. So, one of the people I've worked with the most closely and who supported me since you stepped into this work in the last few years, is Denise Cullen. She is not only someone who organizes through Broken No More, but also organizes with Moms United, who's pulled together families from all across the country who will be standing in front of the UN tomorrow, so that our families, the people we've loved and lost, are recognized. And I don't know, a lot of times you get questions in doing work around racial justice. What does a white ally do? What does a white ally look like? In my world, it looks like you, Denise, and I was wondering if you would share with us also what this drug war has cost you.
Thank you, Asha. First, I'm a mother. I will always be a mother, even though I don't have a child anymore. So that is obviously the primary thing that it's cost me personally. My son Jeff died of an overdose in 2008 after 4 months of being incarcerated, 2 days after he was released. He was 27 years old, and he was my heart, and our little family was broken when that happened. We've been through 12 years of trying to help him with his pathological drug use. He started using it about 15, was in 9 treatment centers, traditional 12-step do-nothing treatment centers, mm-hmm. at least for us, that's what they were. He said he had a fairy tale life. He never blamed anybody for his drug use. He took all the responsibility on himself. He used every drug there was. He didn't start with opiates and die from them. He died from morphine and Xanax, a combination. He had loving parents and a secure home. He was not a minority, born into a minority, but he became one. And then as a result of that, I became one. I watched it happen, I saw it happen, and I felt it. Because when he became a member of that minority, he changed. He became stigmatized, he became an other, and he took on that persona because that's what he heard about himself all the time. He called himself a junkie. I never use those words. But he felt that way. And so people looked at us as we had to be bad parents or our child would not be doing what he was doing. I know that he was born into privilege. He had everything he needed, not everything he wanted, but everything he needed. And an intact family, and my husband and I, and Jeff were very, very close. But I watched as they degraded my son. I watched as they devalued him. And he lost himself in those words, in their beliefs. He internalized the stigma and prejudice of those who saw him as less than human. I watched as my son was broken by their putrid loathing, broken in pieces, such that he would never be whole again. Not in this life. What has the drug war cost me? In a way, I think, Asha, it's what did it cost Jeff? It cost him his life, but before it took his life, it cost him his dignity. It cost him his self-worth, his identity as a human being worthy of respect and compassion. It robbed him of his humanity and allowed those who should have helped my son to instead treat him with contempt. It allowed them to criminalize him, incarcerate him for being who he was, and this drove him further into his addiction. I fought for Jeff with everything I had, everything we had for our son. We walked alongside him, but we lost, and Jeff lost. This addiction, it took his life. My son, as special as he is to me, is not so different than the thousands of other sons, of other daughters whose lives have been lost to the so-called war on drugs. They have been incarcerated or incarcerated now, and they have died. Too many of these sons, too many daughters. They are all precious gifts, but these gifts, so precious to us, are seen as nothing more than trash through the lens of this war. In this war, this time it must stop. My son is not trash. He is Jeff, and he is gone.
Thank you, Denise. You know, Erica, when we sat down and talked a couple of months ago, you know, we were talking about how your father was, after he was killed, it seemed like they sought to justify it by saying, well, he was selling illegal cigarettes. And by that very act, somehow, that allowed them to choke him to death. And we learned very little else about him other than that. And I would like you to tell us in your words who Eric Garner was and what you know really happened on that afternoon on July 14th, 2014.
First, I want to say that Amanda Donzio has been covering up his murder since it happened. And we need to demand accountability, transparency, and for individuals from the private schools to pay your own.
That's right. That's right.
The cover-ups and the corruption still keep on going. I need for Democrats, progressive Democrats, to stand behind the chokehold bill and stand behind the special prosecutor, executive action or whatever. Like, he promised my family a year ago that if it doesn't become in the House as law, that he will renew it, and we haven't heard no whole chatter about it. But who my dad was as a person is who I am today. Like, he taught me everything and prepared me for my journey right now that I'm on. He was a loving, caring dad. He was like my Superman. Like, I never got to know about him. We never had everything we might have wanted, but we had everything we needed growing up. Like, my dad was the type of person, like, he knew his rights. He was harassed for 7 years, and after his death, I looked into it a little bit more and found documents that he put in complaints about being sodomized on the side of the street, being pulled over, just money stolen from him. And My dad was the type of person, like, you're not going to stop me from doing what I have to do, and that's taking care of my kids. He was asthmatic. Yes, he was. He was in the hospital for the first four months of his life because of asthma. He had to have some gland in his nose removed because he needed to breathe. Three of my brothers and sisters has asthma. And I can't understand why Social Security don't view it as, you know, a disability. I have chronic bronchitis, and I know how it feels when your chest get tight and you're trying to breathe. A lot of people say, well, I can't breathe. That became a rallying cry. That became, you know, somewhat of a slogan that people use. But when I look at that video, I see a man fighting, begging for mercy to get back to his kids. He had six kids, two grandkids, and they was his life. My father was a hands-on dad. He was the type of dad that would do my hair with lotion. like he's the type of dad that would play kitchen, cooking show in the kitchen with his six-year-old kids. Like, you know, he was a hands-on dad, but you don't hear about that in the media. And when I noticed by speaking out, I learned something called respectability politics. And what they continue to do is further victimize the family and the victims after they kill us. And they trying desperately to say that my dad was selling cigarettes and that was whatever. There's no law that says that you have to kill someone for a freaking cigarette. Like, that gets me so upset all the time. And I just seen my dad being exploited by artists and politicians and elected officials. And I was like, you know what? Who can better do this but you, Erica? Because your father, you know, when he first had a kid, when he married my mom at 18, he was young. And he told me, he was like, you gotta find a man that's gonna take care of you and your daughter, like, put your daughter before you, like, you know, someone who's gonna love you the way that I loved you and your brothers and sisters, and gonna go out there and get it by any means necessary. Don't come home. He said times that he didn't come home because he didn't have enough money to buy food, so he would stay out and buy bread, milk, cereal, whatever we needed. But he wasn't gonna come home empty-handed because he knew he had children to provide for. And he told me, you know, he told me a lot of things, and I couldn't understand why my dad was telling me all these things. Like, a year before he passed away, he was like, Erica, what you gonna do when I'm gone? I'm looking at him like, you know, don't say that, you ain't going nowhere. And like a year later, he was taken from me. I was living and working in Far Rockaway. It happened in Staten Island, and I couldn't move fast enough to get to him. And I felt so bad when I had to find out on a train that my dad was gone from me. And, you know, it took my family a while to speak out, because there was a whole bunch of people from left field, right field, media, all this other crazy stuff going on. But now I feel like I'm in a position to, like, really. And plus, I just endorsed Bernie Sanders, so now I'm it's not mostly about, you know, Bernie Sanders. Like, I learned about him, but I seen that as an opportunity to uplift my voice, like, to really convey my message. Enough is enough. And that's what my dad said on the video. You can't take this no more. He was harassed because he sold a loose cigarettes, but when you walk to the corner store to the Habibis and get a 50-cent cigarette, and the only thing they get is a fine, and still continue to keep on selling cigarettes, something is wrong. Something is wrong in this country where they see us as a threat. You walk down the street and they see us as a threat. They got these broken windows or stop and frisk, like policies and stuff that's put into place to put us in jail. Stop us from voting, stop us from housing, stop us from having decent jobs, stopping us from breaking us up from our families. Like my dad, even though he was in and out of jail my whole life, I would never know it. Because he was gone for about 2 to 6 months? He'd never been gone for years. They trying to put him out as a criminal. He was never a killer. He was never one of those people that serial raped anybody. He was just being a loving, caring man that wanted to take care of his family. And they took that away from me. And I have to keep on going out and be his voice because they took it away from him. He was actually getting somewhere. He got a couple of officers from that precinct, you know, transferred from there. He was actually getting somewhere, like, by going the right way and putting in these things. And, you know, I felt like it was kind of a retaliation. They lost their friends, this black man that they trying to get him on stuff, and he can't, you know, he pays fines or whatever. But I would keep on speaking out, and that's what I just wanted to say, and that's what drug policy goes for me.
Thank you, Erica. Reluctant warriors, wounded healers, and doing this work. Thank you for coming today and being with us. Let me turn to you, Ms. Joyce Rivera. And really, I wanted to switch a little bit to the question of some solutions. And part of that harks back to a conversation we were having with some of the brothers earlier about how we criminalize or just wipe off everybody who's a drug seller. And a few months ago, you told the most amazing story about how you started harm reduction in the Bronx and really who worked with you and who helped you. And I wonder if you could share that with us today and help us think through how we need to be thinking about solutions to the drug war.
Okay, so I'm really happy to be here, and I, you know, when we started this morning, I love the way it started because it really talked about the dance talked about women and women's power. And
put it in your hand.
I can't take.
You want me to hold it for you?
This one? That's it. No, baby. Let's do it. Okay. I'm like much more.
You know, you don't have a soft voice.
Well, I do have a soft voice. So this morning when we started, you know, in that dance, what I saw was the way we women, you know, just simply call forth the energy in the room. And the energy in the dance. And I think that dance is really important when for this panel and for the spirit that it raised and the importance that it set the tone, and both at this moment here today and in general, that's what that dance does. You know, if you come from my background, you know, what I see as a woman is what it's a message to us women. We started, we invoked spirit, and we work it, and we're really comfortable with who we are. And I see that here, and I'd like to add that there were also disobedient women, and I think that disobedience is the mother of freedom. I've always been disobedient, and I've always, I've done it my way. When I was doing work in the South Bronx, I come from the South Bronx. I'm, you know, born and raised here. I'm a homegirl, and I'm happy about that. When I came to my working in the South Bronx, I met a gentleman. There was activity going on in the park. And it was, you know, for us New Yorkers, we go everywhere. And no one went into this park. Didn't want to go into this. Not every people went, but the people that I was working with didn't want to go. They were afraid. And so the first thing is that being disobedient means that you come back afterwards. You want to find out what's going on in that park. And in that park, I spent time. I respect the big man. All right? I think the big man is doing a lot of stuff in our communities and has done a lot of stuff in our communities. The big man provides jobs. You know, austerity took out jobs. Jail, the drug policy has reshaped our communities into a state of sheer survival and despair. And so the big man is providing, he's also a man that deals with violence. And so I took time to work with the big man because I respect him. And what I learned to do, what happened was, is that in learning to work with the big man, he humanized me. We're all shaped by the drug war. This is received culture. And we are, we also have to work on our narratives. We have to remember our disobedience. You know, the system basically teaches us that we're inessential to our own communities, to our leadership, to every aspect in our lives. It tells us we're inessential. It tells you who's essential. The big man was essential. And in working with the big man, not only did he humanize me, but he became important to the building of a syringe exchange. Because I saw other aspects to him. I saw that he was somebody, he was someone that was interested in, he wanted to know about HIV. He grew. He had other aspects to him that I got to know, and it made it fertile for creation of the syringe exchange. He closed his, when I wanted to do it, I wanted to do it in across the street somewhere in a park, and I was so naive. I was so naive about that, because I didn't get that what we were doing was taking a commercial transaction, syringe, and turning it into a humane one. And by that I mean, you could always cop dope in New York. Always. But you couldn't find needles. So what are you gonna do with that shit? You got the dope, you ain't got the needle. The dealer told me, you can't go and do it wherever you're gonna wanna do it. I did it in his spot. I said to him, you got a cup and go operation here. I got to stop and chat. So he closed it down for 2.5 hours, 3 hours. And that's how it started. I had to stop him from having his guys, it was important to recognize that the big man, that our communities live in huge despair. And that the big man is there because you have to understand, the whole thing is the economy. But in general, it's also that we're blinded to a certain narrative. And that narrative tells us everything, about our identities. And so in how we live. And so you're a drug dealer. You're a bad guy. You work for Big Pharma. You're a good guy, right?
Yeah.
So in effect, but you're in a living, so you're blinded by the fact that you depend on this narrative. Your very identities are coming from this narrative, and you're blinded by that, and it binds you. And so. Being disobedient allows you to decode that.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much, Julius. Before we shift, Deborah, let me ask you to share a conversation that we have often privately and offline. And as we're sitting in a time, mass incarceration to communities that were already vulnerable and increased poverty by as much as 20%, right? They never locked up a single person. They locked up whole communities. It destroyed schools.
Destroyed.
It took away green spaces. You just can go on and on, and in all the ways in which people were harmed. And so here we are, as we've often said, the wind has been at our backs. People are questioning the drug laws. The Drug Policy Alliance just did an incredible sign-on letter where people from Mary J. Blige to Warren Buffett signed on and said it's time to rethink all of these policies. But even as we do, right, how is it that we repair the harms? How do we make whole the people who have been so harmed? Right, even as people are talking about a kinder, gentler drug war. Right, I'm very aware of the marijuana, above ground marijuana industry, that Ohio truly tried to do an oligarchy. It truly did. We have a different looking California now, hopefully, if legalization gets through there, but there's so many people that have been harmed. What is the responsibility that people have to communities that have been harmed, that politicians, that bankers, that so many others who made the decisions to lock up people, to run the drug war, to sell it to us, to make us think that our own children were who we should have been afraid of and criminalized and were okay to be shot down in the street. The way we would raise hell if we had done that with dogs. Right? So I don't even say shot down like dogs. What is the response? How do we repair the harm?
That's a deep question, Asha. One that requires a much longer answer than I have time for. But I'm going to give an attempt. And I want to start by acknowledging who we are, what you're looking at in front of you, which is the tradition of women as change agents. You know, we very rarely talk about the fact that a lot of the major changes that have happened in our society, particularly the ones that have made people's lives better, were changes that were initiated by women. So I just wanna like do a quick little, no. Don't waste my time by clapping, because this is meant to be a teachable moment, like for real. So I was just sitting here thinking about it. And because for me, everything that we do has to be linked to the past. It actually has to live in a frame so that we get what it is that we're doing and what it is that we're continuing. So I start with Harriet Tubman, who was a person who led people to freedom, but more important than that, she removed both the physical and the psychological shackles of slavery.
That's right.
The most important thing that she ever said, from my point of view, was that she could have freed more people if they had known that they were slaves. Removing the psychological shackles is even more important than the physical ones, and that's part of the work that we're doing today. Ida B. Wells Barnett eliminated the denial in America about the reality of lynching. But not just the fact that it was happening, because we had lots of photos of that, but the fact that it was linked to black men's behavior, that it was about black men's predatory behavior. She was like, that's bullshit. Black men are not going around trying to rape white women. They're not even looking at rape white women. You guys are lynching them because you can, because you want to, because you like it. That was some truth that needed to be told then. Rosa Parks. Most of us only associate her with the sit-in on the bus. But before she did that, she was an investigator for the NAACP who kept people's stories about sexual violence. What had her sit down on the bus was the fact that that was a site for sexual violence against black women that went uninvestigated and unprosecuted. And she was like, enough of that. I'm gonna make my stand by sitting down. Ella Baker inspired a whole generation of young people to seize their power, to organize, to demand what it is that they wanted, to establish policies for themselves. And if we had kept her tradition, we wouldn't be having this conversation right now, because we never would have passed the fucking crime bill back in 84, 86, 88, or 94. Finally, my favorite shero, Shirley Chisholm, from the great borough of Brooklyn. First black woman to run for Congress, first black woman to run as president. What was her slogan? Unbossed, unbowed. That is who we are. That is who we must remain to be. And finally, someone most of you have never heard of, but some of you have, Imani Woods.
Yes.
The first sister that I met in harm reduction when I first came into this movement. The person who taught me what it was to actually do harm reduction, and not theoretically, but like practically, with real people, and not just on other people, but on myself.
on removing and reducing the harm that this system has caused me to cause to myself, that I continue to cause to myself. Because if I'm not engaged in harm reduction for me, I can't be about harm reduction for any of you. So that is like the space that I just want to establish as the space for which we have a conversation about solutions and what it is that we're bringing to our community. Because the truth is that we don't need resources from other people to do the healing that is required. We just have to be willing to provide it for each other. And first and foremost, we have to be willing to do the work of healing ourselves. And we cannot make being a do-gooder for other people be a substitute for doing good for ourselves, starting with our families. And I will just say, because I had to think about, like, what is it that the drug war has cost me? It cost me my father, my brother, my brother-in-law, my best friend from law school, my first love, my belief in justice, my belief in myself, my understanding of my own need to medicate, where that came from, and the reason not to make myself wrong, and to actually like seize some power around all of that. So to me, this is a conversation, and I want to echo so much what Susan said about Asha, because this is the space that you're stepping into, that you have stepped into, that you are continuing, is that space of supporting our community in ways that we're not always even present to and don't even acknowledge, and bearing the burden of all that pain that you and I both know that comes with doing this work. Our own pain and the pain of other people, the ones we can help and the ones we can't, and doing it anyway. So I want to just acknowledge that. I want to acknowledge you. But most importantly, Asha, what I really want to acknowledge you for is something that most people never think about, which is the fact that you ask for help when you need it. You call people when you're upset. Yeah. You're like, I need to like just vent today, instead of holding it in and letting it tear you down. That's what has women die early, is the fact that we don't do that. So I want to thank you for being an example of what it is to have a commitment to self as well as a commitment to others. And to understand that if we're not having a conversation here that's grounded in truth, telling the truth to ourselves and to others, then we're not doing anything really good. And now I'm gonna take one last minute to tell some like internal truth telling. So, you know, I'm gonna leave it to other people to talk about the policy changes and things that we need, because we can talk about that, we can read about that. But I do want to talk a little bit about a consciousness change. I want to call out the Black Victorians. Y'all know who you are, all them professional people who think that somehow they know what's good for Black people and who are always our biggest obstacle to progress. The epitome of that is the one who's sitting on the goddamn Supreme Court who refuses to die. In a timely fashion. That's right, I said it, because all of us are going to go eventually. Some of us should go sooner, but nonetheless. Those folks, not because I was just in Sacramento with a group of Black physicians talking about legal weed. And they're like, well, we're really torn about that. We don't think we should support it. And I'm like, excuse me, y'all took an oath that said first do no harm. Why is this even a question? Like, how can you even tell me that legal marijuana is nearly as harmful to Black people as illegal marijuana? Like, to me, there's just no debate about that. Because the whole purpose of having it illegal is to continue to harm Black people. All right, let's just be real about that one. So that's the first part. The second part is that we also need to tell the truth about what's been happening in white communities and the ways in which the drug war harms the white community. And it does it in a couple of ways. But one way, that the obvious way, is in overdoses, all that kind of stuff. But the part that's not obvious that I think we need to talk about in a room like this is how it is that white people are not present to what's happening in their own community. Because the denial of criminalization means that this can't be, my child can't be an addict. My cousin, my so-and-so can't be abusing drugs because those other people do it. They can't be buying it from people that we know because we don't do that. And yet we know that the majority of people buy drugs from people that they know.
That's right.
So how many opiate sellers are there in white communities? Why are we still having this conversation about drug sellers like somehow they're predominantly people of color? That was never true. It was never true. Not before, not now, not in the future. Not true. All right? So I'm not willing to have that conversation anymore. And to the degree that we allow ourselves to continue that, we're continuing a conversation for white people's denial about their own behavior. Because part of the perversion of racism is that it makes black people have a false sense of inferiority and it makes white people have a false sense of superiority. Both of them are evidence of mental illness. Seriously. I'm really not joking about that, because I'm at the place again. I said I'm in my I don't care mode. I say what I believe. I know, but I'm trying to be a little bit more PC. But for me, the thing is this. There is something really perverse, and I'm talking to people of color right now, that has us accept a narrative that white people have a legitimate right to be afraid of us. Like, think about it. 400 years of raping, pillaging, burning, maiming, fucking us over. And we believe that they have the right to be afraid? Like, seriously, what is that? Such that we don't even have to have a gun. All we gotta do is have a beeper and they can shoot us down. And we're like, oh yeah, well maybe they were afraid. Fuck that shit. That is projection. Everything that white people have done to us, including their sexual immorality, their drug use, their addiction to power and money, etc., gets projected onto other people. And mind you, I should be a little bit more specific, because it's not all white people, it's elite white people, because they play that same game on poor white people too. All right, they play that same game on them. They project all of that same stuff on them and have them believe that they're something that they're not. So like, this for me is an opportunity for us to like get, if we could ever get away from talking about drugs as if they were the problem, we could actually begin to talk about what really is the problem, which is the system that we live in that we feel the need to escape from on one level or another, that actually isn't working for us. And I don't know, I don't have the answers to that. This is a conversation for all of us, but Asha, I thank you for creating a space for us to have that conversation, because for me, that's a healing space.
Thank you, Asha.
I feel better right now just because I said what was on my chest.
All right.
You know, thank you.
You brought me up here because I'm the only person who would speak after Deborah.
My brother. Thank you.
Actually, before I bring the next person up, I want to acknowledge some important work done by Deborah. We don't get a chance to talk about it, in part because she does so many other things. But the work that she and Harry Levine, Harry, you're in the house. Harry, stand up. The work that Deborah and Harry Levine did, they were the people that exposed the marijuana arrest, the racial discrimination in the marijuana arrest in New York City, and they educated us about how it goes down. Now, marijuana in New York State has been decriminalized since 1977.
Yeah.
And so the question becomes, how in the hell are you arresting all of these black and brown people? First of all, we didn't even know it was going on like it was until Harry and Deborah probably published their first report. And so without them, without that knowledge, we would remain ignorant and we wouldn't have the evidence. So thank you, Harry. Thank you, Deborah, for that work. Thank you. Now, there are a number of luminaries in this field in the House today. And I apologize that we're not able to introduce all of you all. But I hope that we have some time to mingle and get together and talk. Because for the folks who are new to this, because a number of people raised their hands when Asha asked who had never been to a Drug Policy Alliance event, and there are a number of you all, but there are a number of people in the House who have actually increased our knowledge in this area and has made sure that we have some justice and can push us to get justice. So please make sure you all mingle. But I want to acknowledge one person before I bring up our next speaker. I want to acknowledge Pat O'Hara. Pat, are you in the House? Stand up, Pat, please. Pat is my brother from Northern Ireland, and Pat has educated me, or continuing to educate me, about the conditions in Northern Ireland, where they are all white, but you still see these same sort of egregious acts play out in the drug war.
That's right.
And Pat was the guy who started harm reduction in the UK. And so Pat is, he's been around for a while. In fact, today is his birthday. Happy birthday. Hey! All right, so now I'd like to bring to the stage a former president of the nation. Ruth, you want to come up? Yeah, please. This is Ruth Dreyfuss. She's the former president of Switzerland. Before I give Ruth the microphone, I have to share just a story. Ruth is a dear friend now, but I have to share a story. When I was traveling to Switzerland for the first time, to promote my book, I gave a lecture, and they said the first question would come from the former president. And so whenever people say you got to get a question from a politician, it's like, it's got to be a bullshit question, basically. And one that you can just dismiss. So I gave a lecture. I went through my talk pointing out the fact that the dangers of these drugs have been exaggerated. We have given thousands of doses, for example, here at Columbia, of crack cocaine and a wide range of drugs, and we continue to study those drugs because of you, your tax dollars. These are the same drugs that we're saying that are so dangerous and too dangerous for other people to use, but we give them out on a daily basis. Anyway, so I went through the data, and I pointed out these sort of inconsistencies, and then I said, this is why I think all drugs should be decriminalized. And you know, that was the end of my talk. And Ruth raised her hand in her Swiss way, unassuming, non-arrogant American way. She raised her hand and she said, but you know, we'll make sure, and she understood clearly that I said these drugs were not as bad as we said. And she said, well, why are you arguing for decriminalization? Why aren't you arguing for legalization? This is a former president. Can you imagine any of our idiotic presidents coming anywhere near this?
No.
I can't. We have asked Ruth to come up. I've asked Ruth to come up so she can maybe help us to understand what is it that we can ask or we can expect from our presidents, our former presidents. What is it that we expect from them in terms of providing some of the solutions that these questions were raised from? So with that, by the way, I should tell you, Ruth was a little concerned about her English. Her English is fine. Her English is absolutely fine. And I should also tell you that in 3 years, I will be moving to Switzerland. Because Ruth is now working on illegal immigrants, and so I'm going to immigrate.
To be honest on this stage, it's clear that I raised this question to come, but it's also clear that we don't have the legalization of drugs in Switzerland. I was for 10 years responsible for the narcotic laws in Switzerland as a minister of health, which is a great advantage, but I couldn't legalize the drugs. So the question was to somebody who made this motivation, this rationale. And I thought as an academic, he should go further. But as a politician, I was not able to go further. I tried, I continue to try harder. I am no longer in government, but I am a member of the Global Commission on Drug Policy, and we are fighting for regulation of all drugs all over the world. So, but I didn't succeed in my own country till now. So, yes, I was very moved about what you, your stories, and very mobilized also, and energized by what you told. I think what is very important, the role of a politician is to make the problem visible and to make the people who has to be respected, all the people. I mean, to go in the open scene, to meet the people, to show the people how they are, to show that they are able to have a reasonable consumption, that they are able to have a family, that they are able to have a life, even if they are consuming drugs, even if they are dependent on drugs, not only consuming, because as we know all, dependent people are a minority. And drug consumers are those who generally can consume in a reasonable or controlled way. So I mean, I think the first duty for a politician is really to show the reality and to show respect to all the people, because all your stories are stories of loss of the recognition of your dignity. And this is, I think, the real problem that is dividing our society. In Europe, it is perhaps less a problem, a racial problem, but it is always the same problem. It's a problem of the poverty. It's a problem of the non-respect of the people. It is, you were talking about your son being not a trash, but it's considering people as trash, considering people as no value. And I think this is the first duty of the politician to say nobody in this country is trash.
Let me also ask to hear from Pastor Kenneth Glasgow, who leads the Ordinary People Society and the Prodigal Child Project, and has been one of the first partners that we ever had in DPA. Going back to when we were, I think, six of us around the table at 70 West 36th Street. And Pastor Glasgow, from a faith perspective, and everything that you've done, all citizens and organized, and somebody who's been incarcerated, who has represented the formerly incarcerated community so brilliantly,
the
formerly incarcerated
and
convicted people's movement. Would you reflect on some of the things that the sister said about the cost of war and solutions for peace in about 3 or 4 minutes, and then we want to open it up so that we can hear from all of you.
First of all, I want to really, really echo what they said, Asha, about you. And those of you that don't know, even though I'm a pastor and all that, I haven't been the most faithful one at getting all this accountability and all this, paperwork, right? You know, some of y'all look real good on paper. You work for damn on the streets, but you look real good on paper. And so I'm going to thank you, Asha, because Asha was able to equalize that out a along with others, to make sure that the work, the people that really do the work, yeah, and don't look good on paper, are presented to DBA in a real, real, you know, intentional way, so that they can get funded to continue to do the work, you know. And to those of y'all that do have those technical skills and all, I don't have the fingers to do it, so it wasn't my job. You continue on, don't stop me from doing mine. But what I heard today, first and foremost, as a man, I want to apologize to the Oscar and Susan Bergman, and I'm going to try not to cry, and the Deborah Smalls, and Miss McCullough, and Denise, and all of y'all, because I'm one of those preachers, you know? And some of us preachers have a tendency to look at women in a different way. I want to uplift Shira for straightening me on that. And inside this movement, I've learned some things from dealing with you women. And I'm not saying that in a misogynistic way. I learned that we never counted y'all. We never thought about what y'all was going through. We always wanted to know why the hell you're not catering to us. And you know, Susan had to really, really make me see that. And then I got around Lorenzo and Dawson. I was wondering, you know, are they a little sweet or what? Why are they so worried about the women? You know, and I learned that. So when I come in here and I'm sitting next to Stephen and I'm hearing it, I'm trying to write and I'm trying not to let Stephen right there see me because I'm crying. Because I'm thinking about Susan Burton and I'm thinking about my own mother, how she got breast cancer and liked to die while I was in prison. And I hung up the phone on and said, I can't hear that. And my daughter, I'll never forget, she called me back. I called them back. They couldn't call me in prison. And she said, why you hung up on grandma? I said, I ain't hang up on my mother. I hung up on whatever that was, talking through my mother, trying to tell her I'm going to die in prison. Whatever that demon was and all that. And what I'm trying to say is y'all women have a way of making us realize we demonize a lot of people in the faith-based community. Me and the young lady, please stand up. Stand up. Yes. She's over race and all that in the UK and in England. Excuse me?
The Church of England.
And she's addressing them with all that stuff. And what I heard in reflection to you, Susan, and you, Denise, and what I hear in you, Erica, is that, you know, we lost. We suffered just as much as y'all did, if not more. Because y'all was the ones that we depended on to get, that got the old commissary in there on time. Y'all were the ones that we cussed out when it wasn't there on time either. You know, y'all were the ones that we depended on when we couldn't go to courts for ourselves or go to the lawyers or go and see the parole officer, or go to see somebody about trying to get us out. You know, and I sat there when I was listening to y'all speak today, and I thought about all the changes I took my mother through when I was locked up. You know? And I just want us men to acknowledge the fact that we've really been taking advantage of our women. We really depend on them so much for a lot of things. It made me think about what the man said earlier when the woman was in charge, it will get done. And we always had y'all in charge. We just didn't never let y'all know it or accept it ourselves.
Oh, we know it.
Yeah.
Brother, we know it.
So to hear the wrap up and to hear what Deborah Smalls was saying and what you were saying about the drug war, and especially with the president, I'm like, Dr. Carl, that ain't never in my life but I hear president of a country talking about legalizing drugs. But to hear that and to hear it come from women, I want y'all to know one thing, that we as men, we declare this day, and we declare that we will be behind you. The faith-based community have been one of the, you know, we slow on the road of coming up to par. So, you know, you have to give us a little bit longer. But now that you have us here, my last words will be, hold us here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And I want to ask a question. I want to also ask for a final reflection because I know Lumumba has been sitting here spinning all day for us. But really, Lumumba, was born really with red light and being spoon in his mouth and his fist in the air. The Mandelas are a long line of organizers, and it's the only way that I've ever known you to be. And
so I wonder if you can think a little bit about this panel, especially the extraordinary work that you do to end police violence and police brutality through your work at the NAACP Legal Defense Fund.
I'm going to be quick. Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, thank you all, panelists, for very thought-provoking and honest sharing. What I'd like to offer in reflection is actually to all of us who are participating in this discussion in these seats here, is for us to reflect on where we stand and our proximity to the issues that we've heard. I think it's always safe for us to be in these spaces and to be the amen corner and to be very supportive of what we hear. When we go back to our spaces, we don't reflect what we were amen here, right? And so if we believe a lot of what we're nodding right now, how do we make sure that's reflected in the spaces that we worship, the spaces where we work, the spaces where we learn, the spaces where we love, all of those spaces that we begin to share what we heard, what we learned, even if we don't agree. But we begin to talk, we begin to grow, and we're not afraid to do so. Whenever I come to DPA spaces, I'm always challenged. And I like that, because I am uncomfortable in spaces where I'm not hearing anything that challenges me, right? So to be uncomfortable and sit in the space and say, well, let me think about that, I appreciate that. And I want to challenge us to really be able to really hold ourselves accountable, that if we really are supporting a lot of what we're hearing about it, then we need to act, as many people say, don't talk about it, be about it, right? And I would also challenge for us to think a little bit more ahead. I think a lot of what we are hearing, we know, is different manifestations of what has come in the past and things that will continue to happen. We know about broken windows. We know the stop and frisk. We know all of that. Let's be very clear about the understanding that it will happen again, and be observant of those patterns. So when we see it again, we're able to identify it.
Observe it. Speak out about
speak
it.
Speak out about
don't
it.
Don't be scared.
That's right. That's right. And then understand that it is what
person.
It is.
It only takes one person to stand up and speak up.
Absolutely.
And the rest will fall in line.
Absolutely.
So say it, Erica.
And as the last DPA thing, finally, I want to also challenge us really to think about it. We talk about folks who are incarcerated and folks who have been just really cast in a way that we really begin to give some thought to those who are really in the worst of the worst category that we consider to be able to be throwing away people on death row. I would really, really like for us really to push this conversation in those spaces to people who have been deemed to die in prison, right? Whether it be by lethal injection or by life without parole, whatever it may be. But for us to continue to raise those people's concerns, their existence, and allow their experiences to enter our conversations.
Let me just say something that it doesn't get away from me, Erica. So every time there is a killing, a police killing, it reverses, and I feel the pain in the loss of the day that I lost my son. In particular, when your father was killed, they flashed his killing for 2 days.
Mm-mm. Months, two years.
Okay, well, I cut the TV off. So,
yeah, over
so,
and over.
So, but repeatedly, yeah. I saw him being choked on the streets of New York. And it was horrifying that they would show that over and over and over again, as if we're gonna get desensitized to watching a black man killed.
We are.
Exactly.
As if, you know, men and women.
And women.
Hanging from trees years ago as we walked by. It was just fast forward for me to the 21st century.
And I want you to know that we feel the pain, the grief, the loss, and are shocked. And I feel as though
we traded in crosses.
They traded in crosses for badges and white hoods for blue uniforms. And at the end of the day.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you.
Let me open it up for Dion. And if anybody else wants to ask a question, please hold on now. As you can see, we're running an hour behind, which I expected as your fault, not mine. But I already have some time. But Dion, the mic is yours.
Thank you all so much. I love y'all, and I love, you give me love. In a way that Deborah is teaching me about compassion and love that I don't always have. And I don't really have a question. I have more of a reflection that it wouldn't be me if I didn't say it. But as we are looking at the narrative that's placed before us, I want people to think about how the war on drugs, how that policy really enters the lives of women. Not just about how we take care of our men in jail, or the loss of children, but also the policies that are in place that are directly affecting everyday life for women because of the drug war. It is why we test women who are on welfare. Yeah. It is why we have people who say, we're gonna take your children because your boyfriend sold drugs.
Yeah.
It is why women are being killed, not just the story of Treasure, but across this country where women who are involved in sex work, women, cisgender women and trans women are put on the block basically to give police information. So I couldn't sit here and not say, when you think about the levels for women, when we have people who say that we can't work with women because they're too sensitive.
Or complicated.
They're complicated. Well, I want y'all to know I run an organization called Women with a Vision, and none of the fucking women that walk through my door are that sensitive. And they ain't tender, and they want a place to protect themselves.
Yeah.
We have to put the power in the hands of women who are also being affected.
Thank you, Dion. That brilliant point. It's also okay to be sensitive. I'm a crying motherfucker.
I'm a crier.
You know, when I can put my stepson in the ground, I cry a lot more. But he wasn't the only lost man I've had. But I want to say this too. Men are sensitive too. They just tend to get away with it. They call it rage. They curse you out. They speak at you on the phone. The number of men I've encountered doing this work who have spoken to me disrespectfully. And I'm somebody who's considered to have the power and authority.
Right.
It's beyond the pale. And so if women are sensitive, so are you.
Yes.
So are you. And that is true too. If not, we wouldn't get cursed out. We wouldn't get hung up on. We wouldn't be spoken to ridiculously. None of that would happen. Because sensitivity sometimes shows up like crime, and sometimes it shows up like rage.
Yep.
Ms. Carter, I am so glad that you're here, and I'm so glad that DPA brought us all here. DPA does so much great work, but one of the things they don't talk a lot about is policies regarding some of the drugs and the drug policies that are causing the most harm to our communities, which are alcohol, tobacco, and pharmaceuticals. And I think as we're talking about changing the narrative, we have to ask ourselves, how do we include talking about these policies? Because you know, racist tobacco enforcement was a factor in your father's death. How do we incorporate talking about these policies into our narrative of how the drug war needs to end?
Yeah, I think it's a little unfair to ask your answer to speak on behalf of DPA.
No, I wasn't trying to do that.
So I'm actually gonna move that question and start with Deborah.
But she has a comment.
Okay,
she wants to make a comment.
I just want to make clear that there's a lot of women in our history that stood up and been strong and been leaders of this nation, like Harriet Tubman and all them, and people that's in this Black Lives Matter movement that been on the forefront and been fighting and stuff. So women, we have a chance to stand up. We just gotta have the courage to do it.
We just got to do it, baby, do it.
So I think that is important for us when we talk about, like, why people are arrested for drugs, for, you know, selling Lucy's or whatever. Those are this era's version of the pig laws. For those of you who read either Michelle Alexander's book or Slavery by Another Name, and this is why I always bring history into the conversation, because it's not about the specific crime. It's about the right and the ability to surveil, to arrest, to detain. We are a country that is addicted to punishment, and we're also addicted to extracting resources from Black people. That's the reason we were brought here, that's the reason we have kept here, and the only reason that people can actually justify in terms of a power thing our existence is as a source of extraction. And that's not just for Black people, that's Americans. We are being extracted. And so the laws are there to justify that. And so it's wrong for us to get hung up on whether or not it's about alcohol, tobacco, whether it's sugary drinks, whether it's food stamp fraud. I mean, they will come up with 1,000 little kinds of misdemeanor type offenses to criminalize people for. The thing is the result, which is criminalization. And I want to leave you guys with two thoughts. One comes from my friend Ruthie Gilmore, who gave this description of racism, this definition, like 15 years ago, I've never forgotten it. She defined it as a series of policies and practices that are developed by one group of people to be imposed on another group of people, with the final result of it being premature death. So I just want you guys to sit with that for a little bit. And then the final thing that I wanted to say, because this came up in another question, was about reparations. I continue to use that word because it's the word that is needed. It's not enough for us to make policy changes and agree to do better without repairing the damage that has been done. And this country is still suffering because we did not repair the damage of slavery or genocide against the indigenous people here. The failure to own your harms causes great agita on the people who caused the harm, as well as the people who are the recipients. So if we're ever going to get past this problem of racism in America, it will only come when we're willing to own the full truth of all the harms that have been caused and make a commitment to healing.
Thank you so much. Let me just make a note about the time, since none of y'all have paid any attention to me today whatsoever. We were supposed to break at 3:15 from this panel and come back at 3:30 and start the last panel. We still have one more to go. We'll try to collapse that a little bit, but I do know that I built into 6:00 because I know how you are. That said, we're going to stop at 4:15 so people can take a breath and breathe for a minute. And so we have now 9 minutes or so to go through the next 4 questions or comments that we're going to ask. So please be mindful of that and anything we say or respond to.
Just take both of your questions.
To stop, I don't think that everybody hears it. Is everybody going to ask a question or make a comment?
Comment, question?
You have both. So why don't you come here and ask, do you have a question or a comment?
It's a mouthful. It's a comment that I'll make.
Can we do it in 30 seconds?
Yeah.
Let's try it again. Go ahead. Why don't you ask the first question?
This opens the panel, and I want to get your thought on the irony of incarcerating so many Black and brown bodies for so many decades on marijuana, and now a white male taking charge of profit from this legalization of marijuana.
Come on, baby.
Thank you. So we're going to stack. So we're going to come back to that. Just like 30 seconds. Make it tight.
My name is Vera Tomano. My issue is on federal minimum sentencing. My brother, Omani Calhoun, also known as 290-23280, is in federal prison, sentenced to 15 years, just finished 3 years. This was a case that went all the way to the Supreme Court, made national news, based on a comment made by the federal prosecutor. At this point, everything that's been reported is what's been reported. No one has come to the family to ask about this issue. If a federal prosecutor can stand in a federal courtroom and make a racial comment, what else is in that courtroom transcript? we've been right at the upper of the year. And then Adam Klasfeld with the courtroom news.
What was the comment?
You have to get
the comment was with African Americans and Hispanics with all that money in the room, did the light bulb go off in your head that this was a drug deal? Mind you, there were no drugs. These people were set up by federal agents to keep the national news. No one is talking about it at all. We know that police officers are shooting people, but we are not realizing that the prosecutors are doing the very same thing with pen and paper.
Yes.
I just wanted to bring an international perspective. I have an international perspective. I'm an Afro-Latina sister, and the work that I do has to do with internal displacement around drug that's happening in Colombia, Panama, Belize, Honduras, Guatemala, Mexico, et cetera, et cetera. And that we have to have these conversations because all the stories here are stories that I've heard in every single country throughout the region. So, and the faces are exactly the same faces. They look like me, they look like every single woman here. So I just want to put that on the table that the quote unquote war on drugs is not funding like policies around like great, better, whatever. It's funding murders,
you think that
it's funding displacement, it's funding incarceration, and it's funding men,
genocide,
children being disappeared,
yeah,
and women receiving death threats for protecting their land, their ancestral land, and tax dollars from the United States is doing that.
Thank you so much.
And then, I appreciate your moderating style, Asha. I think you should be in everything that includes black people ever.
Every day.
Deborah, I love that you brought up the economic justice angle in terms of dealers. There's so much money around.
Hold on a second. What is that? Stop that. Stop.
It's so much compassionate language around addicts and none around the economic violence that creates, dealers. But I'm also wondering, I've been asking this question about for the past year about in this libertarian dominated space, how black people are going to be participating in the above ground economy, because I think we have a right to. And so specifically, if we know of any women-led cooperatives who are farming, who are buying dispensaries, I want to be a part of making some of this money. I want to be a drug dealer.
Thank you. Thank you.
Asha, I want to be a drug dealer too. And I'm working. Hold on. I'm working really, really hard in California to get this, marijuana off the ground thing. But I want a dispensary. Can I have a dispensary? Can you help me get a dispensary? I'll get the money. Ethan, where are you?
So does anybody want to take a last moment on the reparations question? Because that was the main thing that was being asked by both people. So on marijuana and the above ground industry, does someone want to speak just to that? Just to the above ground industry? Erica, the above ground industry, that's all you're talking about?
Well, basically, there ain't no black people that own the dispensaries. But what I would say, they have the end of the world war on drugs, and we need more investments in our community with the economic struggle that we're going through. That's what I would say. No more war on drugs. I don't want to hear nothing else about policy.
Hold on.
We need more education, housing, and schools for our government.
Asha, I just feel like, me and much of my community put front-end dues on this marijuana thing, and now that it's coming back around, I want a dispensary. I want to pump that money back into my community. I want to heal the war on drugs, and it takes resources. Ethan. Yeah.
Call it out, Sue.
Ethan. I'll come up with the money for the distillery. I just want the opportunity to have a distillery.
It's a serious distillery.
It is.
About who gets to own business.
That's right.
So let me take a second. Let me ask my colleague, Lynn Lyman, to have the last word on this.
Come on, Lynn.
Because in California, she says, no, she doesn't want to do it. You don't want to talk about it, that's not the way to go.
Ethan.
Ethan doesn't want dispensaries either.
So I want to have the last word.
I'm sorry, because you know, New York City is predominantly a Latino city. All right? So let's get this straight here, that we're not listening to Latino voices. And I want to talk about, and you want to be a drug dealer? Well, you know what? We have drug dealers, and they haven't been successful. But the people that work with them have been. The people in the community have done a great, in some respects, a really good benefit an investor in our communities, which is probably what you will or won't do. But working in communities, peers, drug dealers working with all of us on harm reduction, peers, community prohibition. We made it possible for this meeting to be here. Right. We brought a fundamental idea of civil disobedience, but also the humanity that makes us all create safety. And if it wasn't for the harm reduction, what would this, how would people be able to talk about opioid, what kind of services would you be able to get for the opioid numbers? It's hard to be despairing. You would be at nowhere to go.
Thank you.
You would be experiencing that. Oh, I'm sorry, but you know what? I gotta talk my truth. And my truth is that working in communities with everyone is a human rights thing that we all have to do. Because it creates a movement. And a real strong movement that allows others hiding, unable to be out there who have their own truth.
Hey, I have to call it out, Archie.
All right? We create protection. It's an opportunity for others who have their own voices with whom we have solidarity. Because fundamentally, right, it's not just race, it's class. Right? People in our own ethnic groups have been against us. Right? Because of class. And if I was living in Harlem and I was in the media and I had just come up in the 60s and I had my degree and I'm taking advantage of all the nonprofit opportunities that offers me. And I'm sitting there, I'm stuck because I can't take my drive, I can drive my car around because of racial segregation. So I'm going to get pissed at my own people.
We gotta grab that.
So,
you know,
economic, as well, race, class, those are the
issues.
Thank you, Joyce.
All righty. Okay. So, Dream
actually asked you the question, Deborah,
so
let me just let you.
So, I just want to say very, very quickly, how many people here have ever heard of a susu?
It's not just.
The New Yorkers? Okay, so I have a couple of proposals. One, I think that we should really, to the degree that we're going to have legal marijuana businesses, we want to think about them being co-ops.
Yeah.
It's an opportunity for us to begin to create a different business model. And people individually can't do it, but together
and
people
can
pool their money and like look at that one way. But the other, and that's where the susu comes in, because we actually do need to make some demands of the industry. And so my suggestion is that we actually have what I call like a fund for growth, a social venture networking fund that would be come out of the profits from legal marijuana that could be targeted for communities that were the victims of disparate drug law enforcement. And that money would actually be matched by money that people in the community save, like a susu, okay? So that you actually have skin in the game on both ends. So that the growers create a fund and that the people save up for the fund and that the money can be used for any legitimate purpose, because the reality is that poor people need access to money from non-predatory lenders. So what I want us to be in a conversation about is not just how we use this for marijuana businesses, but how do we use this as a way to undo what I call the patterns of legal looting that poor people are subjected to every day.
Yeah.
And that would be the beginnings of a form of policy-type reparations.
Thank you so much.